It's love that lights the way. Amen. I'm not going to keep you long this morning. Just want to talk a little bit about something that's, I think, is important, and it's going to continue in the vein that I've been going over the last few weeks. And you know, we've been dealing with changing our minds. And last week, we talked about being alert and not giving the enemy a foothold. Amen? Because he is subtle and he'll slip in there. And he wants to derail us from God's purpose for our lives. And we said last week that a big part about being alert is learning to change how we think. Amen? Amen. Romans 12:2. Be not conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. And we talked about having an open mind, an honest mind, and a humble mind in order to be open to God working in our lives. Because if our minds are not right, and we know that, I explained to you that when we talk about the heart, it's not the organ that's beating behind the ribcage. When the Bible refers to the heart, it's talking about your mind, your emotions, your affections, your imaginations. And these are the things that you have to guard, what gets into those things. And we also learned that from one of the parables, the parable of the sower of the seed. Remember? And sowing the seed on the soil, and the different soils was a different kind of hearts. And if the soil is not right, then the seed cannot grow. Amen? Amen. So the seed has to go into soil that is conducive for growth. And that is why we have to fix the soil, which is the heart. So if there's something wrong, we have rocks in the heart, and because of unforgiveness and all these type of things, we need to fix that. Otherwise, no matter how much word you get, it ain't gonna do anything. Because the seed is being sown on unfertile soil. So I want to talk a little bit this morning about things we need to overcome. Things we need to overcome in order to mature us a little bit more in our walk and help us in our process, in the process of being stronger believers. Let's pray. Father, I ask right now that I decrease and you increase. Holy Spirit, have your way. Speak to us. Even now, prepare our hearts and our minds to receive your word. And give us the courage to put it into practice. In Jesus' name, amen. One of the things we need to overcome is learning how to overcome situations in our lives. And all of us have stuff. We don't always talk about it. We dress up and come to church and act like everything is okay. But as long as you're living, you got stuff. Amen. And I guarantee you, if you ain't got stuff by now, just live a little bit longer, it's on the way. Amen? And we need to get over our day-to-day situations, and everybody's situations are different. But we need to learn how to go through situations, whatever they may be, in our lives. And it's the way we think that helps us to get through these situations in a positive way. Amen? Because we all got stuff to get to deal with. Peter MacWilliams said this: to avoid situations in which you might make mistakes may be the biggest mistake of all. Because you know, our ways ain't like God's ways. And like I explained last week, humans, or the week before when I was talking about Jeremiah, we don't like pain. We don't like discomfort. But a lot of things that we learn and matures in our life come through going through difficult times. Amen? But avoiding difficult times may be the biggest mistake of all. Amen? Lou Holtz said this: show me someone who has done something worthwhile, and I'll show you someone who has overcome adversity. Amen? In Joshua, Joshua spoke this, the Lord spoke this to Joshua: study this book of instruction continually. Meditate on it day and night so that you will be sure to obey everything written in it. Only then will you prosper and succeed in all you do. This is my command: be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid or discouraged, for the Lord your God is with you wherever you go. Study this book of instruction continually. Meditate on it day and night, as you will be sure to obey everything written in it. And then what the Bible says? Don't say, mm-hmm. What did the Bible say? The Bible didn't say, mm-hmm. I want you to know what the Bible says. I want you to be sure you know what the Bible says, and you ain't gonna walk out of here with a mm-hmm. What does it say? Right. But it says, only then what? After you've studied the book continually, meditate on it day and night, only then will you what? Prosper and succeed where? In all you do. It's in the book. This is how you overcome. When you study this continually, then you will prosper and succeed in all you do. The reason why we are going down this vein of changing the way we think is because whenever we hear that word prosper, you know what we think of? Material things. There's more to life. You can prosper in so many other things than material stuff. But you see, that's why we got to change the way we think, because the world will make you think that if you don't have stuff, you ain't nobody. Amen. You are actually a failure. You could prosper in your health. You could prosper in being stressless, because you're happy with who you are and where you are and what you got. And you ain't worried about what somebody else got, because you're content with where God has you and what he's done for you in your life. That is success in the Lord. Amen? Amen? The Bible says we must be in this world, but not of this world. But we swallow the value system of the world. And that's why we got to change this mindset. Are you hearing me this morning? Amen. That is why we have to have an open mind. Because God's ways are not our ways. And if we don't have an open mind, we'll miss what God is doing in our lives, even the miracles he wants to perform. I talked about this last week. Because we got a God that'll spit and dirt and wipe it on your face. If you ain't got an open mind, you'll stay blind. Amen? You can't tell him don't wipe dirt on your face if that's what he wants to do. The secret to overcoming as human beings is really dividing our circumstances and situations into things that you can change and things that you cannot change. One of the problems we have as human beings, we like to hold on to stuff, first of all. See, God gives us principles, what we need to do. But we like to hold on to stuff because we got control issues. And we too like to try and change things we can't change because it's what we want. Amen. See, when we want something, we want to make that happen. And when it don't happen the way we want to make it happen, we upset. And we're constantly trying to work out ways to make something happen that can't happen. Amen? And in each of our lives, there are different situations. And you got to identify it when you see it. I'll give you an example. Unforgiveness is one. Someone do something to you and legitimately hurt you. Okay, they hurt you. That is why God has the principle of forgiveness in his word. So when they hurt you, what do? Forgive. So 2 years later, you can't be holding on to that stuff and throwing it up in his face or her face because of what they did. It's time to move on. You cannot turn back the hands of time and change that. But because of that one little incident, if you don't put the principle in place, you will never move forward into what God has for you. Because you're too busy trying to change something that can't be changed. Do you all understand what I'm saying? And we fail because we persist in holding on to stuff we need to let go of. I'd like to have that job. I didn't get the job. The interview didn't go the way I want. I have a job. I've been working on this job for 2 years, but I'm still thinking about back then when that man didn't give me the job 2 years ago. I'm upset. I'm depressed. And it doesn't only affect you. I keep saying this. It affects those that God has blessed you with. Your spouses, your children, your siblings. Because they get around you and they say, "What's wrong?" What's wrong is you're making yourself depressed over a situation you can't change. We need to move beyond this place. Change the way we think. We need to understand the difference between faith and fantasy. Somebody once said, for every problem under the sun, there is a solution. Or there isn't. Amen? We got to take both into consideration. If there isn't, move on. Amen? If there's a solution, ask God to show it to you. If not, move on. God has given all of us gifts. And when you discover and develop and start to use them, he'll give you success in the face of seemingly impossible odds. Ignore what you can't change and focus on what you can, and opportunities will begin to reveal themselves. Amen. Amen. Another issue we need to address is our emotions. Big. Do not let your emotions dictate your direction in life. While our emotions can be a gauge of how we feel and also what we need to change in our lives, never let it alone dictate your decisions. If you ask anyone who has performed at the top of their game, you'll find that much of their time is spent overriding their emotions. Do you all hear me? And you got to deal with that, because your emotions will derail you. Feelings come and feelings go. And here's where an honest mind, we talked about having an honest mind, here's where an honest mind comes in. Because I said, if you feel sad, then say you're sad. But then deal with it. You're not saying it because you want to stay there. You're identifying it so you can move from there. Amen? You get up in the morning and roll over, and then in your mind, I don't feel like getting up this morning. Why? You got to be honest. Did you stay up on your computer all night till 3-4 o'clock in the morning playing games? Now you feel bad. You don't feel like doing something that you're supposed to. Well, you got to change your behavior because that job is paying your bills. And if you follow that emotion, you'll be fired. Amen. Amen? Amen? So change your habits. Change your behavior. Maybe you eat too late. Maybe. We need to start identifying these things because they will work against us. However, listening to your emotions to get to the core of what's bothering you can be a good indicator of where you are. But be careful. Be honest about your feelings. Identify it and do what you need to do to move on. If you're not motivated, talk to God. Read His word. Paul says in 1 Corinthians 9, 26 and 27, "So I run with purpose in every step. I am not just shadow boxing. I discipline my body like an athlete, training to do what it should. Otherwise, I fear that after preaching to others, I myself might be disqualified." What he was saying was, I'm running hard to the finish line. I'm giving it everything I've got. I'm not going to be living sloppy. I'm going to be cautious about what I do. I'm staying alert and in top condition. I'm not going to get caught napping. We talked about being alert. Because here I am telling other people what to do, and I myself might miss out myself. Another thing we must overcome is ignorance. You know, people don't like that word, ignorance. When somebody says ignorance, everybody, the hair stand up on the back of your neck. What are you calling me? What are you saying? Does everyone know what the meaning of ignorance mean? What does ignorance mean? Say that again.
Not knowing.
So what's so offensive about not knowing? Because if you don't know, you don't know. I don't know everything. If I need to ask somebody, I'll ask somebody. If I operate in ignorance, if I did something because I didn't know it, I didn't know. But that's something we need to overcome in order for us to move forward in our lives, to be more mature. And the fact is, if you don't know something, then do what you need to do to find out.
Amen.
Someone said, stupid is forever, but ignorance can be fixed. Amen?
Amen?
But you know, that's where a humble mind comes in. We talked about being humble. Because some people just don't want nobody telling them what to do, even though they don't know. But they sure don't want you tell them. Amen? Lord, help us. I don't know, but I.
Come on, man.
Far too often we fail to see that seeking out information and expertise is not a bad thing. You know, some of us men, we don't like to ask for directions. And we'll drive around for 2 hours. Before we stop and say, can you tell me where so-and-so is? Thank God for GPS these days. You know, young people are under a lot of pressure to get jobs. And because they're under pressure to get jobs, sometimes they will go for a job rather than get educated. They undervalue the value of education, of higher education. Even in life, sometimes you may be promoted beyond your level of competence. But I guarantee you that if your life doesn't follow and you don't educate yourself, you may lose that job, even though initially you got it. We got to educate ourselves. If we don't know, then ask. And especially when it comes to this. Amen. A lot of times we are so ignorant when it comes to this. Amen. And you know why? Because we won't pick it up and read it. I want to read a couple of scriptures from Proverbs. Joyful is the person who finds wisdom, the one who gains understanding. For wisdom is more profitable than silver, and her wages are better than gold. Wisdom is more precious than rubies. Nothing you desire can compare with her. She offers you long life in her right hand and riches and honor in her left. She will guide you down delightful paths. All her ways are satisfying. Wisdom is a tree of life to those who embrace her. Happy are those who hold her tightly. Wisdom. Ain't no shame in finding out how something go. Drop that pride. Humble yourself and find out so you could be better. Because in fact, you look more stupid when you don't do what you're supposed to do and the answer right over there. But you got too much pride. And these are some of the things we need to overcome in order to move forward in our lives, to better ourselves. One of history's greatest victories happened when faithful people followed God's guidance during the Battle of Jericho in Joshua 6:1-27. And I encourage you to read that story. The Battle of Jericho in Joshua. Joshua 6, reading from the first verse to the 27th verse. The city had massive walls, and they fell down. And once they fell down, the people were able to get the land that God had promised them. And in that story are principles we can use today in overcoming obstacles we face in our lives. I know many of you know the story, but I need you to read it. But just an overview, the story tells that God told Joshua that Jericho would be the first city that they would take, but the city had huge walls. He told Joshua to tell the people to march around the city once for 6 days, and on the seventh day, to march around the city 7 times, and the walls would fall down, which they did, and the walls fell, and they were able to conquer the city. One of the principles that we can learn from this story. The first one, focus on God's power rather than on the size of your problem. When you talk about overcoming, you can't look at the stuff. You got to keep your eyes on God. A scripture that I keep bringing up here, it says, I will keep those in perfect peace whose minds are stayed on me. Amen? Focus on God's power rather than on the size of your problem. Here is where an open mind comes in. No matter how big your walls may seem, be assured with complete faith in God, it will fall in God's time, in God's way, if we totally trust Him. That's letting go of our control issues. Either we can be Lord of our lives, or we can let Him be Lord of our lives. Amen? Amen? God is bigger than any obstacle that we face. Do you believe that? Here the word comes in again. See, this is why we need the word. Because the word says, but without faith, what?
It's impossible to please God.
It's impossible to please God. So you got to have faith. God is bigger than any obstacle. You got to believe that by faith. Amen? When you focus on how great God's power is, you'll be able to see your problem from a right perspective. And then you get the confidence to know you can handle it with God's help. We need to choose to see our obstacles as opportunities to mature our character, changing the way we think. Because once we come to God, anything that comes after that has not come to kill us. We're now in the will of God. So whatever comes is to mature you, to get you to a place. It's that mind, the giant up here. But you got to believe this. And y'all are going to hear me say this over and over until we get it. We can't stop stuff coming in our lives. But we can change the way we deal with it. Amen. Amen? Amen? Choose to see your obstacles as opportunities to mature your character and also to increase your faith while you trust God to lead you through the process of overcoming. It's for you to help you achieve the purpose for which you were born. Amen? And I know sometimes that seems so hard. I always share, you all know that I was very sick, almost died a few years ago. And I had people coming to me and saying things like, I was so encouraged the way you handled your illness. Thank God that they were encouraged. Listen, y'all know how I struggle through that. Amen? I almost died. But that's why I tell you a lot of stuff we go through ain't for us. It's for somebody else. Amen? Amen. All God wants is our obedience. And in it, we grow in our faith. Because no matter how difficult it is, when the next thing comes, we say, well, Lord, you bring me through that. Amen. I know this is just another thing for you to work out in my life. But would I have chosen that route? If I stand up here and tell you that, I'll be telling you a lie. Amen? But that's why we got to change the way we think. Because once we come to him, then we need to let him take the wheel. Amen? Knowing that wherever he takes us and guides our steps, it's for us. That he ain't come to kill us. He come to mature us. Another thing, trust in God's plan even when it doesn't seem to make sense. You want to overcome? Then trust in God's plan. You got to let go of them control issues. When we go to God, we can't go to God and then tell God how we should do it. Go to God and let him lead you and just trust. You ain't got to understand. Because, you know, if the children of Israel had listened to Joshua and Joshua say, God promised us this land. And they say, well, we were farmers. How are we supposed to fight these people? Look at that wall. What are we supposed to do? And then he comes back to them. God said, we must march around the wall. And they said, for what? I mean, we trying to win the city. What are we marching around the wall for? How is marching around the wall helping our situation? But either you can trust God or you ain't gonna trust God. Even when it doesn't make sense to you, trust God's plan. God's plan for your life may seem unconventional. It may seem mysterious. But from our human perspective, that's how we see it. But God's ways are above our ways. Whenever you decide to trust God's plan for your life, you can count on God to deliver on his promises and to bring all your circumstances, even the toughest challenges, together to accomplish his purpose. Ask the Holy Spirit to help you cast aside the fears that come. And then we need to think. This is why we can't take our eyes and our minds off of God. In the midst of all of that, you need to remember how much God loves you. We got to think about the love of God. And we just read, there is nothing that can separate us from that. You know, situation we go through can stop. You see why we got to do this? In the midst of that, recall God's love. And you say, God, I know you love me. The more you focus on God's love, the less you'll feel afraid. Be willing to say yes to whatever God asks you to do, even when it doesn't make sense. Amen? And watch real progress happen in your life as you overcome those challenges. Another thing, see the supernatural in all situations and pursue what is right, holiness. Ask the Holy Spirit to help you recognize the extraordinary ways God is working in all the ordinary situations in your life. You know, we come to God. God is our Father. He's watching over us. But we're so busy seeing things from the world perspective, we don't even see and understand the supernatural ways God is protecting us on a daily basis and guiding us. That one over there, house burning down. That one over there, sick. That one over there, doing all these things. And you're just taking it for granted that what you're going through, ain't none of these things happening to you because you're lucky. You are being covered by God. And when you do what God asks you to do, he does what he says he will do.
Amen.
And with God, favor ain't fair. Amen? He will do things in your life and for you that you look at other people and you wonder, well, why are they going through that? It's because you've been covered. And we got to see the supernatural in our situations. God is working all the time. All the time. Simple things. I was talking to someone yesterday. Last year, they had 3 car accidents. And of course, when you talk to most people, no car accident is your fault. It's always somebody else's fault, right? But even so, you know, I went home and I just said, thank you, Lord, I didn't have one.
Amen.
But you got to see the blessing in that. Some people go through a year, don't even go in the hospital door unless they go to visit. Never been to the emergency room. Their children, well, never have to go to court, stand before some judge to plead their case for their child. God, you praying and covering your children, and for the whole year, God, cover your children. Your prayers have been answered.
Amen.
You got to see God in that. Amen?
Amen?
You don't act like he ain't there. But we need to see that, and we need to acknowledge that. These are the things to help us to mature and overcome. God is working, because when you have that, nobody can take that from you. And any situation that comes, you already know what he's done.
Amen.
Amen? And then every day, try to grow in doing what is right. It'll make you stronger and better and able to overcome challenges. We need to put our relationship with God in the center of our lives and allow God to empower us as we practice the spiritual principles and disciplines that he requires from us. Things like prayer. We need to pray. We need to not to forsake the assembling of ourselves together. These are the kind of things that we need to acknowledge and as best as possible try to do. Be faithful and have a zeal to discover and fulfill God's purpose for your life. Help you to overcome. Another thing. Surround yourself with other believers committed to the same goal. Big, big, big. Who is loudest in your ear? Huh? Sometimes God can't get in because you're too busy with your friend. The second something go wrong, instead you drop on your knees and go to God. Ding, 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 ding. You know what just happened? Then that one ain't tell you something. You hang up from there and go to the next one. By the end of the day, you're so confused with everybody telling you what to do. Mm-hmm. At which point, instead of looking this way, you can look this way.
Amen.
And if you want to know what to do, Jesus on paper right here. We got to change the way we think. Because whether you think about it or not, it affects you. Who you listening to?
Amen.
We talked about words. Words affect us. And the words we take in is affecting our lives. That's why we need to take these words in. And let me tell you something. There's always somebody out there ready to tell you what to do. Amen?
Amen.
And if you let people, they will dictate your life. As much problems as they got in their own, they still will tell you what to do. Then you be like a chicken with your head cut off, trying to do what this one say, and trying to do what this one say, and trying to do what this one say. I know what the problem with that is. When you don't do what this one say, then they have a problem with you.
Amen.
Now you got to deal with that situation. See, we don't talk about these things, but you know, we all going through this stuff. And we got to know how to overcome these things. Amen?
Amen?
It's the way it is. So be careful who you have around you. Amen? Other believers, you need to surround yourself with people who are striving to overcome their challenges and can lift your spirit and remind you of the truth and encourage you towards achieving your goal. Be careful having people around you who encourage you in your dysfunction. If they can't tell you you're wrong and you need to change that, you don't need them. Because a lot of us do a lot of bad stuff, and we just want someone to agree with us. We need to find someone who can. Amen. Sister Tijuana. I'm sorry. I saw the way you look at him just now. Lord help us. I saw that look just now. But you know, this is real.
Amen.
This is real. Be careful. Be careful. And then you need to do the same for others.
Amen.
Amen? This is why surround yourself with believers committed to the same goal. Another thing, keep putting one step in the front of the other consistently to make progress.
Amen.
You know, stop looking from side to side and letting things distract you from what you know God has set you on a path to do.
Amen.
And all you gotta do is keep walking. Keep stepping. Keeping your eyes on Jesus.
Amen.
It gets difficult, just put that next foot forward. Holy Spirit, empower me, strengthen me to take the next step. I'm keeping my eyes on what the Lord has said to me. I don't understand everything. I don't see where this is gonna end. But God, if you said go there, I'm going to go. Because I believe if you bring me to it, you'll bring me through it.
Amen.
Every day, choose to take the next step the Holy Spirit is leading you to take. Don't give up. Don't get frustrated. Because when frustrations come, identify it and move on. Identify it to know that this is a place I can't stay. Don't set up camp. Don't dig no foundation and pour roots there. This is not a place for me to stay. Don't give up. Remind yourself that God is actually working on an eternal timetable. You see, we don't think in terms of eternity. Everything is rush, 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 and, you know, we got the microwave mentality, nuke it now. But you know something? Eternity is a long time. God ain't no rush. You know what I mean? The race is not for the swiftest, but for the one who endures to the end. The problem is the world system says get it and get it now. I know how you can get it. Come to me. Amen? We got to watch the world value system. Always remember you, once you've come to Christ, you are in the kingdom of God first. Do you all hear me? It don't matter what the world say. We're supposed to be in this world and not of this world. But too many of us won't be in the world and want to be like everybody else. That's a problem. That's a problem. Everybody worrying about what somebody else think about them. We need to worry about what he think. Because he's the one who got heaven. Amen.
Amen?
These people ain't got no heaven to put you in. Remind yourself. Keep putting one step after the other. Every step you take with God would result in something worthwhile. Every step, no matter how it looks. I don't know if you all remember last year, I preached a sermon. Nothing that we go through is wasted. You remember that? There's a reason why you go through what you go through. And somewhere down the line, you will be able to use that, if not for you, for somebody else. Amen? Amen? Everything. Everything. Blessings will come by obeying God's instructions every step of the way. You know, in that story, because of their obedience, the walls came down. He said, march around for 6 days one time. And on the seventh day, march around seven times. Ain't shoot no spare, ain't do nothing. All they did was obey what God said. Amen? Blessings will come, by obeying God's instructions every step of the way. God will reward you for faithful obedience along the journey of overcoming your challenges. When we obey God in small ways, he will lead us to greater levels of faith. And we will be able to move forward to victory over challenges and obstacles in our lives. And remember, victory doesn't always mean things work out the way we want them to work out. Amen. Victory means things work out the way God wants it to work out. That's that humility. That's why we got to die daily to self. Because until we kill self, a lot of times self won't let us let what God wants to do in. Amen? Here's where your humble mind comes in. Accepting it's not all about you, but it's about putting God first. You know, it's not always about the destination. A lot of it has to do with what we learn on the way, what God is teaching us on the way to what he has promised us. Amen? So let's seek to learn all the valuable lessons God wants to teach us as we learn to overcome. As our walls of challenges gradually come down, we become confident that God is going to be with us on our journey. And at the end of our journey, we will experience joy. Amen? Things we need to do to overcome. Trust God. Obey God. Surround yourselves with believers. Keep putting the steps, one step at a time. And learn to rejoice in every step. Learn to thank God in every step. Don't just think nothing happens until the end result comes. Jesus has already died, and he has already said, I come that you may have life and have it more abundantly. Every day, you can have that abundant life. Your life is blessed when you have your husband. Your life is blessed when you have your job. Your life is blessed when you have your children. All of that you need to be able to enjoy. And you can't be so into yourself and selfish because you want something to happen that didn't happen that they can't even enjoy you. They ain't do nothing to you, but you mad over something you can't even change. And you can't enjoy the life that God has already blessed you with. Amen? Do you all see what I'm saying? But it's a mindset. Don't allow this life to take the life that God has blessed you with away from you. And you got evil people in the world, and they'll do it. That's why when they do their foolishness, forgive them and pray for them. Change your mind. Put the principles of God into practice and overcome these situations. Did it hurt? Yes. God helped me deal with that hurt. And let me go home and enjoy my children. Let me go home and enjoy my husband, my wife. Amen? I am not going to sit in a stew and let this thing overtake me and take my day away. The devil is a liar. And stop letting him lie to you and say you need to stay there. Is a lie from the pit of hell. He don't want you to enjoy the life God has already given you. It's already been ordained. We talked about this. It was ordained for you before you were even conceived in your mother's womb. And Jesus didn't die. The cross is finished. It's done. It says it is finished. Stop giving him the power. Because he don't have no power than what you give him. That's why change the way you think. He can fool with your head, but you cast them down in the name of Jesus. Bring those thoughts under the obedience of the word of God. And run his behind. Amen? Amen. We got to be radical, or he will take our lives away from us. And that's his job. But knowing this, there goes that ignorance. Knowing this, we need to seek the information we need to deal with it. Amen? Amen. If you don't know, then find out. And I'm telling you this morning, there's a way to defeat him. Keep your mind on God. Amen? Amen. Let's stand. I want you to remember this morning that life doesn't get better by chance. It gets better by change. Do you all hear what I'm saying? Life doesn't get better by chance. It gets better by change. And change comes from acting upon what you know. Do you all hear what I'm saying? Amen. Change comes from acting upon what you know, what you think. That's why you always hear me say, if you change the way you think, you'll change the way you are.
Amen.
Do you all hear what I'm saying? So we need to be careful about our thoughts. And make sure that our thoughts are being inspired by God's word. It's time we stop this notion of thinking that we need to be like everybody else and be ordinary.
Yes, yes, yes.
Because it robs us of a chance to be extraordinary. And eventually it leads us to mediocrity. Stephanie, can you pull up 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 9? Listen to this. But ye are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a peculiar people. You all hear that? We are peculiar. That we should show forth the praises of him who hath called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. You ain't supposed to be like everybody else. And don't feel bad about it. Amen?
Amen?
We are unique. We are different. We're supposed to handle things differently. So as we overcome, I want you to keep this scripture in mind. John 16:33. Jesus is speaking. I have told you all this so that you may have peace in me. Here on earth, you will have many trials and sorrows, but take heart because I have overcome the world. You are overcome? Then trust in the one who has overcome the world. Amen? I never like to close the service unless I invite someone to come to Jesus who don't know them in the pardon of their sin. If there's anyone who wants to accept him this morning, this is an opportunity to do that. Become a part of the family of God. You can come to the altar. We will pray with you for you, or you can stay in your seat. Ask him to come into your heart. Ask him to forgive you of your sins. He will throw those sins in the sea of forgetfulness, as far as the east is from the west. You don't have to leave the way you came. You may be in a backslidden position. It's never too late to come back. Just ask for forgiveness. And he will repent and move forward. Amen? It's not about people. It's about you and God.
Amen.
If you do know Jesus in the pardon of your sin, then you're welcome to take the Lord's Supper with us. The tables are open. We do it privately here. We take the cracker that represents his body, the juice represents his blood, and we go back to our seat. And in our own way, we remember the sacrifice that Jesus made. So come, let's continue to worship in this way. The altars are open, the table.